You know, that last song, it's the first time I heard it. Maybe it's one you guys do regularly around here. I don't know. But you convinced me that you believe that. And I'm telling you, you're not going to regret one day of your life serving, surrendering to Jesus. This morning we have Pastor Don Immel with us. He's presently serving as the chairman of the Board of Trustees of our university. He also is the superintendent of the Pendel Ministry Network. And we're so honored that they are here. The whole team is here to bless us today. It's going to be a great day. So let's give a warm welcome to Pastor Don Immel.
Thank you for that. That's just, wow. Let's just go home now. That was worth it all right there. It is such a delight and a privilege to be with you. So many moments. Now, I have to warn you about something. I'm a little bit run down. We've had a really busy week. And when I get run down, I get really weepy. So if I just start bawling, pray for me. Hey, can I introduce you to my wife, Robin? Would you stand? This is my beloved. So many memories come flooding back in times like this. I remember when the walls were right here. So much knee time. Around the front of this auditorium, around the altar, and just getting close to Jesus. And when I come in the room and I see you, so here we go, and engaging with the Lord and loving on Jesus. And Riley Ingolito, where are you, Riley? Riley came from our church in New Stanton, where her dad is now pastoring, and I texted your dad during worship, I have to confess, and his heart is warm today. But my heart is warm just because of being with y'all and spending time in the Lord's presence. But we've got to get right to it. So let's go to Matthew chapter 13 this morning. And the title of my message simply is the title of the passage, The Sower and the Seed. It's the fate of four seeds. It's very simple kind of a passage of scripture. We open it up here. That same day, Jesus went out of the house, sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat, sat in it, and the people stood on the shore. What a great day to be around Jesus. And he told them many things in parables, and he said this one. A farmer went out to sow seed. As he scattered the seed, some fell along the path and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it didn't have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched. It withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 160, 30 times what was sown. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And I think that's what I'd like to kind of proclaim to you as we move into this passage today. Do you have ears to hear? You know, sometimes we have ears and we can hear and somebody's talking. How many of you have ever been in a conversation where you kind of tuned in and tuned out? That's probably going to happen a little bit in the next 30 minutes. I get it. But Jesus, he's challenging the listeners, tune in, sit up, pay attention. If you can handle it, I've got some things to share with you this morning. And that's the admonition that I'd like to share as well, is let's have ears to hear and a heart to receive what this parable would teach us today. Every Christian is found in this passage. Everyone in the room is somewhere in this parable. This was an agrarian society. In other words, if you wanted groceries, you planted them. That's the way it was. And when Jesus is telling this story, the people who were listening, could track with Jesus without any problem. They had sown seed. I'm sure many of them had their own gardens or had their own farms, and they totally got what Jesus was saying. There's different, there are three primary pieces to this parable. First of all, there's the sower. And Jesus will explain this later, that the sower is, this is the preachers, the prophets, those who teach, those who proclaim the word of God. They sow the seed, whether in a sermon or in our witness. Then there's the seed. It's the word of God itself. It's a great analogy. The word of God being seed, because, you know, seed always starts out small and grows into something big. And it's seed, a little seed, you can hold it, you can hold hundreds of them in the palm of your hand, but one seed has so much potential. Have you ever seen a seed crack a sidewalk? Of course you have. The tree grows up, the roots grow out, and the cement comes up. It happens. Someone once said, you never know how many seeds are in a watermelon, and you never know how many watermelons are in a seed. Seed has all kind of potential. And the seed of the word of God has been scattered across our world over many centuries and millennia. And the word of God has had powerful, life-changing, culture-altering effects when it was sown. Because of the seed, because of the word of God, and the fruit that it produces in people's lives, we have hospitals all across the United States and all around the world. Over where I grew up in the Pittsburgh area. Got a little witness there. We had Presbyterian Hospital, Mercy Hospital. All across the United States, there are hospitals named after churches and denominations. Because why? Because the seed of compassion was sown in someone's heart, and it grew with tremendous results. There are orphanages all around the world that have resulted because someone sowed some seed. There are great compassion programs like Convoy of Hope, Mission of Mercy. A dear friend of ours down in Manassas, Virginia, started a ministry called Christ in Action. It's a disaster response ministry because the seed, the word of God, was sown in someone's heart and great things grew out of it. The sower is the preacher and the proclaimer of the word. The seed is the word itself. And the soil, my friends, the soil is us. It's your heart. It's my heart. And I want us to take some time this morning to examine the soil, the condition of the soil of our heart. Now soil's a funny thing. I'm not a great gardener. But I decided a couple of years ago to plant a little garden in my backyard. And one of the things I wanted out of this garden, I really wanted free watermelon. And so I planted the seed, I tended the soil, I watered the thing, and I got one watermelon. And it was this big. It was the weirdest, funkiest looking watermelon you've ever seen. And then I noticed my tomatoes were not growing correctly. They were dwarfed, they were splitting, there were different things. And I asked somebody, I have a friend who is a master gardener. I said, what is the problem? He said, it's your soil. Your soil is lacking calcium. That's why your watermelons are doing that thing, and there aren't enough nutrients in the ground. He went on and he explained this whole thing to me. The condition of the soil is imperative if the soil is going to produce long-lasting good fruit. And so this morning, I just want us to take a few minutes and look at four different kinds of soil that Jesus is talking about in this parable. So we're going to skip down to verse 18. The disciples have a conversation with Jesus. They said, what does all this mean? What are you getting at? Yeah, we get seed, we get soil, we get fruit, but what are you talking about? And Jesus said, listen to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is the seed sown along the path. If you've ever walked along a farm, you'll notice that sometimes there are fields, and in between the fields there are tractor paths. In older days, it's where the animals would walk. It's where the foot traffic would walk. And these paths were necessary so that you didn't go walking through the plants and the plantings that had taken place. And what happens after traffic continues to walk on these paths? It gets packed down and it became hard. And the first image that Jesus gives is the sower going out, and he'd have a satchel across his waist, and he'd reach in and he'd grab seed and he'd throw it out, and some of it inadvertently would get over to the hard-packed paths. What causes a heart to grow hard? That's what that soil is representing. And I'll tell you, one of the things that I've learned, and it seems to go along with this passage of Scripture, it was oftentimes foot traffic that was packing down this part of the soil. People sometimes harden our hearts. Have you ever had a friendship, a relationship that went sideways? And your heart got hurt, and when our heart gets hurt, we protect it. We protect it with what psychologists call defense mechanisms, and it can harden our heart. Sometimes it's the people we're called to work with. Sometimes it's the people we're called to work for. Sometimes it's the people we're called to serve that can harden our hearts. Last month I had the opportunity, it was a wonderful time, I was in Cairo, Egypt, and spent time with Paul and Kristen Mathias. They were on staff here, and with the Live Dead team there in Cairo for a couple of weeks, just doing some resourcing, counseling, coaching, and those kinds of pieces. One of the things that we know in ministry settings is sometimes the people that we're called with to serve with can irritate us, get under our skin. Say something. How many of you have ever just said something you didn't mean to say and it came out and it was wonky and you could tell from the look on the other person that, oh, that didn't come out the way I wanted it to, or something that was inside me did come out and I wish it hadn't. Have you been there? It's happened to us all. And in this parable, Jesus talks about how the enemy, the evil one, will come and steal the seed from that soil, and he deceives people. And I think it's sometimes because relationships have gone sideways and we got hurt. And I've seen it happen time and time again. I've been in the ministry for over 40 years now. And many times the people who lose faith, step away from God, walk out on their faith. I think of a dear, dear friend of, it breaks my heart. I'll use the name Larry, but his name is Larry. And Larry was a lonely guy, but Larry found himself a great, pretty wife. If you knew Larry's background, he was deep into alcohol. And God came into his life and absolutely delivered him from a huge bondage. But the gal that that Larry married, although a believer, was unstable, and the marriage didn't last but a year. I watched Larry as his spiritual formation climbed this great mountain, and he was doing great and living for Jesus and loving God. His life had been redeemed. He had been restored. He was now a successful businessman. But a relationship that went sideways packed his heart to hardness. And it was just a matter of months after his wife left him and the divorce was final, and I knocked on Larry's door one Saturday morning just to see, can we redeem this again? And Larry, at 8 o'clock in the morning, was flat out drunk. He wasn't able to put two words together. And Larry, come back. And in that slurred speech and in that state, I'll never be back. Never. The last time I saw my friend Larry, he was one of those guys standing in the middle of the street with a sign, begging for money so that he could get food, but everybody knows, also booze. Nobody starts a race to fall down flat on their face. We have to guard our heart, the Bible says. Proverbs tells us, guard your heart. You've probably heard this before, and I believe it bears repeating. In a great atmosphere like this, it's really easy to become nominal and calloused and allow our heart to become impervious to the movement of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus says, guard your heart. Watch the hardness of it. We need to move quickly. Verses 20 and 21 talk about another type of soil. This is the hard heart. Now we get into the one who received the seed that fell on rocky places is the man who hears the word, at once receives it with joy, but since it has no root, say no root. It has no root. What does that mean? It's shallow. Lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, he quickly falls away. Friend, your roots grow deep. That's the point I think that Jesus is making. Received it with joy. There was a transformation. There was quick growth. But there's a warning here that persecution and trouble are also part of life. Can I get a good amen? The trouble comes. The rain falls on the good and the bad, on the just and the unjust. Tough times come to us all, whether we deserve it or not. And if we are unprepared, there's a chance that during that season of trouble or trial or even persecution, that our roots will shrivel up and the faith that we have been nurturing will die quickly. Jesus made it clear that following him was not always going to be a bed of roses. And if it were a bed of roses, you know what come along with roses? Thorns. It happens. Jesus said in John 16, 33, in this world you will have tribulation. We're going to go through trouble. But he said, be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. If we're rooted in culture instead of being rooted in our faith, culture is ever shifting and our culture is shallow. We need to nurture our faith, spend those quiet times with the Lord, encourage one another in our faith and in our growth and in our formation. I was walking through the woods, love hunting, and walking through the woods chasing a deer. And the week before, we had had a windstorm come through, and there was this great big 60-foot pine tree laying in the wooded area where I was walking through. And it was the oddest thing, because the tree looked strong and broad and green and robust. It looked to be in good health, but it was pushed over, and the whole root ball was sitting up on the ground. And I recognized from looking just at that tree and its roots, although the tree was tall, 60 feet tall, its roots were really shallow. And the wind came and knocked it over. I think sometimes that happens in people's lives. The third type of soil is the thorny soil. Verse 22, the one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it and make it unfruitful. Luke 8:14, this parable is being taught again, and it says it this way: the seed that fell among the thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature. Worry is a big day in our age today. Anxiety is rampant. It's almost epidemic. It's so important for us to learn how to trust God with the day in, day out needs of our lives. Not only to have faith in what we want God to do, but to have faith in what God is doing while we're asking Him to do what we want Him to do. I've seen faithful followers of Jesus lose their joy, victory, and faith in Jesus because of their anxieties. Worries discourage, distract, and ultimately defeat us. And so Jesus encourages our hearts. What does he say? Matthew 6:25, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you'll eat, drink, about your body, what you'll wear. Life's more important than just these things. So don't worry, Jesus said. Seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and those other things will be added unto you. Three things in this soil that choke out. They're weeds. There's anxiety and then wealth. Whereas worry is in reference to the lack of possession, this next problem is the abundance of possessions. Church history reveals that the church flourished under persecution and faces decline under abundance. Isn't that weird? It would seem to be the opposite. It's a paradox. And I think it's the same thing, the same thing's true in our lives. When things are a little tight and there's a little bit of pressure, it sometimes presses us in closer to God. How many of you pray more when you have problems than when everything's going well? I think all of us, that's a tendency, it happens. The weeds here are worries, wealth, and thirdly, pleasures. That which stimulates the senses. Many people are addicted, choked out by the things that stimulate their nerve endings. So today we have all kinds of artificial stimulants that people are locked into. Drugs, alcohol, gambling, these kinds of things. Natural stimulants as well. Friends, how's the soil of your life? Hard packed? Sometimes. Shallow and rocky? Roots not going real deep? Sometimes that happens too. Other times, and back to my garden, the thing that we probably hate the most with regard to doing a garden is weeding. That is just sweaty and unfun. There's just never anything fun about it. So one year, I just let the weeds grow. Guess what happened? The weeds took over. The things that I planted died out. The parable that Jesus is giving came true. You know, the same thing's true in our lives. Do you have worries? Do you have cares? The pleasures? These kinds of things? Guard your heart, the proverb says. And then finally, there's fertile soil. And I just sense it. Thank the Lord. I sense such a great atmosphere during our time of worship this morning. And I could sense a fertileness in the student body here. Thank the Lord. I want to encourage you. Keep that going. The one that received the fell, excuse me, the one that received the seed that fell on good soil is the man who hears the word, understands it, produces a crop yielding 100 or 60 or 30 times what was sown. All of us face the previous three conditions of heart and life, but thanks be to God, we always have the opportunity to improve our soil. Ezekiel said these encouraging words, and I'm going to close with this and ask the worship team to come up, please. Ezekiel 36, 26 through 28 reads, I'll give you a new heart and a new spirit in you. I'll remove from your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. In other words, he's going to take away the hard pact and make us sensitive. I'll put my spirit in you. And I will move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. These are great words this morning. Listen, friends, I sat where you sit. I feel like the psalmist who said, once I was young and now I'm old. And I'm getting older every day. Thank God, that's a gift. When we were at Valley Forge and in our freshman year, there was the excitement and the newness, the freshness of a college experience in a Christian environment, and it felt great. We went 2 years and 3 years and 4 years, and by the grace of God, and for some unknown reason, they gave us a degree. And I remember as we left this place, and there was a brief season of grief and mourning as we said goodbye to each other. And there were 12 of us who all left Valley Forge Christian College at that time, and we went to the same seminary. It wasn't a plan, it just kind of happened that way. And you would figure that in that atmosphere, that's a guarantee everyone's going to end up good. 4-year Bible degree, now we're seminary students. You know, the devil's wicked. And you know, life gets hard. Sometimes poses some challenges that we never saw coming. And although there's many of my colleagues and friends that continued on into ministry and fruitful, productive adult life, there were a few who the enemy was able to sidetrack. And I watched one dear friend absolutely fall away from Jesus, never to return. How can that happen after 4 years at Valley Forge and going through seminary? It happens. How do I avoid that? Tend the soil of your heart. Be aware that without attention and diligence, we'll put we'll put prayer time off another day. That's it. We'll put chapel off, and we'll little things. Solomon said, "The little foxes spoil the vine. Little distractions. The enemy's smart. He's been doing what he's been doing for many thousands of years. And he knows, he watches us, I believe that, and sometimes he comes in and just overwhelms. And other times, he picks at us, one grape at a time, one little thing at a time. How can we avoid that? How can we avoid? Tend your heart. Number two, stay in community. Two are better than one. A cord of three is not easily broken. Tend to your own soil and let other people help you with it. One last story and we're done, because I'm 33 seconds over. Stories told of an African community that came en masse. They came to Christ together. And it was their habit as a community to find places of prayer in the jungle where they could go and be alone, spend solitude with God. And every now and again, somebody would become distracted and stop going to their place of prayer and solitude to be with God. They had this saying in this African community, "Brother, I see there's grass growing on your path." It was a kind confrontation. It was a loving way to say, it is becoming apparent that you are neglecting that place you go to. That's what community does for us. Loving each other, to care enough, to urge each other to that place of closeness with God. We're going to wrap up. And we can do, "Lord, I give you my heart." Would you stand with me? And let's just sing this morning as we examine the soil of our heart and what's growing there. How's it going? Growing well? Ready to produce? I hope so. I pray so. But otherwise, let's do some weeding work this morning as we seek the Lord. Let's get rid of some of the stones and the rocks in the soil. Or if hardship, maybe hard relationships, has packed down our soil, let's ask God to cultivate it a little bit more so that we can draw close to Him and stay rooted in Him.
church, to plant a church. It wasn't someone I would have raised up, although I'm a church planter. I love planting churches. And in the end, that church would last a year. I just remember being on the platform and my prayer was that simple. Lord, keep my heart soft. Because I know the only way I can produce a harvest is if my heart is right. So I want to encourage you to keep the conversation going, maybe in your small group, maybe in your dorm, maybe around the lunch table. Just ask somebody the question, you know, when was the time that your heart was tempted, tested to turn hard? And what did you do? What did you do? What was the step that you took to keep your heart soft? And that way we can be accountable and encourage each other throughout the day. Well, the Pentonville Ministry Network is here. The entire team is here to bless you down Heritage Hall today. They want to let you know that they think about you as college students and some of the things that you need. There's going to be a lot of goodies there. You grab a bag. They'll give you instructions. Pick up some of those things. Have a great day, and we just love you. We pray for you often. God bless you.